One increase and one decrease is called a kalpa. Increase refers to that part of the cycle when people's lifespans increase and reach 84,000 years. In every 100 years, the average height increases by 1 inch and the average lifespan increases by 1 year. The period of increase is followed by a period of decrease in which similarly, there is a decrease in 1 inch in height and of 1 year in the lifespan every 100 years. Our present kalpa declines until the time of Shakyamuni Buddha. When the average lifespan was 80 years, the decrease has continued. And today, the average lifespan is around 60 years worldwide. Now, people say that some people live for 90 or 100 years. That is correct. But some people only live to be 10 years old. And others just live to be 20. 60 years refers to the average lifespan. Some people live a little longer and some live for a little less time. But the worldwide average lifespan is around 60 years. When the average lifespan reaches 30 years, a block will come which will be fatal for anyone who contracts it because there will be no medicine to cure it. 80% of the population of the entire world will die of this block. Only people living in the mountains, in the countryside, or in distant places where the disease cannot reach will survive. When the average lifespan reaches about 25 years, the disaster of fire will erupt. At that time, seven suns instead of the one we have now will blaze down from space. How will seven suns be able to appear? They will appear as retribution brought about by the power of living beings' karma. Now we are beginning to explore space, and this exploration will turn to exploitation as we plunder the resources of other worlds. Without any reason, we humans do not stay where we belong, but we feel that we must go to other worlds and ravage other people's possessions. As we continue to exploit space, we will decimate the moon, and it is then that seven suns will appear in the sky. At that time, the whole world will become a volcano, and will all the rivers, lakes, and seas will dry up. There will not be any oceans because this world will be destroyed and burned dry. Up to the first Dhyana heaven, this disaster of fire will be the first of the three great disasters which appear at the end of a kalpa. When the average lifespan is 20 years, the second disaster, that of water, will strike. After the disaster of fire, when everything is burned and there is nothing left, in the midst of that, nothing will appear something. As water comes forth from no water, there will be a transformation in space. A vast amount of water will flow forth, and this world will become a vast ocean, a world of water. First, it will become a world of molten fire, and then it will become a world of water. The disaster of water will flood everything up to the second Dhyana heaven, so that even the gods in the second Dhyana heaven will drown. At this time, the human race will be nearly extinct. After the water disaster, when the average lifespan is between 15 and 20 years, the third disaster, that of wind, will occur. It will be even fiercer than the disasters of fire and water. It will blow all the way to the third Dhyana heaven. The six desire heavens too are blown to bits. It is said that in all six desire heavens, there are the five marks of decay. The six desire heavens are the heaven of the four kings, the heaven of the 33, the Suyama heaven, the Tushita heaven, the bliss from transformations heaven, the comfort from other transformations heaven. In each of these six desire heavens, the five marks of decay afflict the gods just before they die. What are the five marks of decay? 1. Gods wear a flower crown. At the end of their lives, the flowers wilt and dry out. 2. The clothing of the gods is always very clean. When the five marks of decay manifest, their clothing gets soiled. 3. Gods do not perspire, even when it is hot. When the five marks of decay manifest, their armpits begin to perspire. Once Vimalakirti told some cultivators with perfumed bodies, "Don't emit perfumed fragrances. If you do, living beings will become attached when they smell you, and they will become greedy for your fragrance. So don't emit such fragrances." 4. The bodies of the gods are always fragrant. Not just one god is fragrant, but all of them are. When the five marks of decay manifest, they lose their fragrance, and their bodies begin to give off a foul odor. This stench is the fourth mark of decay. 5. Gods can always sit in Dhyana Samadhi. They are not like people who resemble monkeys. If we don't go to one place, then we will go to another. Gods, on the contrary, always sit in meditation and possess Dhyana Samadhi. Moreover, they do not speak very much, unlike people who cannot get everything said in a day and continue to talk ceaselessly through the night. When the five marks of decay manifest, the gods cannot sit still, and when they try to meditate, they are always moving in one direction to another. Unable to sit still, they get confused, and when they get confused, they fall. This is when gods die. So, gods, at the end of their lives, manifest the five marks of decay, and thus there is the saying, in the six desire heavens, there are the five marks of decay. When the wind disaster reaches the third dhyana, all of the desire heavens are destroyed. Even if you have cultivated to the third dhyana heaven and are reborn there, the disaster of wind will blow you away when it strikes. It is said, those who cultivate to neither thought nor no thought are not as fortunate as those who go to the west. After someone is born in the western land of ultimate bliss, he can return to this world if he wants to teach and transform living beings. Therefore, birth in the western land is a better state than birth in the heaven of neither thought nor no thought. After the wind disaster, there will be few people left alive. Those who are alive at that time will mature very quickly. When the average lifespan is 10 years, there will be another fierce epidemic and many people will die. After this is over, the period of increase will begin. Every 100 years, the average height will increase by 1 inch and the average lifespan will increase by 1 year. This rate of increase will continue until the average lifespan is 84,000 years. A cycle of increase and decrease is called one kampa. 1,000 of these kampas is called a small kampa. 20 small kampas constitute one middle-sized kampa, and 4 middle-sized kampas equal one large kampa. When a world completes the final stage of extinction, it remains empty for a time and then it begins to grow. This period of growth lasts for 20 small kampas. 1,000 kampas make up one small kampa, and 20 small kampas make up a middle-sized kampa. There is growth for 20 small kampas and stasis for 20 small kampas, decay for 20 small kampas, and emptiness for 20 small kampas. Growth, stasis, decay, and emptiness make up one cycle of a world system. After a world is empty, it will again grow, and after that, there will again be stasis, again decay, and again emptiness. There will be growth, stasis, decay, emptiness, growth, stasis, decay, emptiness, growth, stasis, decay, and emptiness. Our world system is constantly subject to growth, stasis, decay, and emptiness without end. Just as people are born and die, are born and die, are born and die again and again. This process continues endlessly because living beings are inexhaustible and the afflictions of living beings are inexhaustible. Yet, if it could be the case that any of these were exhaustible, my vows would nonetheless still be inexhaustible, but they will never be exhausted. There will never be a time when any of them can be exhausted, neither will any of my vows. My vow power can never be exhausted. With my rest of jewels in boundless lands in all directions, I make decorations and offerings to the first come ones throughout all the boundless Buddha lands of the walls of the 10 directions. With all the myriad jewels of the walls of the 10 directions, I adorn and make offerings to all first come ones, thus generating the kind of merit and virtue that is the most supreme. For ends as many as the most of dust in lands, I bring the foremost peace and joy to gods and humans. I bring the most superior happiness to gods in the heavens and people in the world. I make offerings for as many compass as there are dust motes in all the lands throughout the 10 directions. Yet, if one believes in these kings of vows supreme, if there is a person who can hear of the supreme and wonderful practices of these 10 great kings of vows of universal worthy bodhisattva, as they pass by the ear but a single time, and if in search of bodhi one thirstily craves these vows, if one sincerely and earnestly seeks wonderful superior bodhi and craves these vows, just like a thirsty person craving a drink of water, then the merit and virtue gained will that surpass. If his mind has a thought to seek bodhi and craves these 10 vows, then his merit and virtue will surpass the merit of one who makes offerings of jewels as numerous as dust motes to first come ones and adorns all their lands. The merit and virtue of one who earnestly wishes to practice the 10 kings of vows and sincerely seeks bodhi surpasses the merit and virtue of those who offer jewels to all the first come ones in the 10 directions. Sutra, with bad advisors forever left behind, from paths of evil one to pass for eternity. Soon to see the first come ones limitless light and perfect Samantabhadra supreme vows, easily obtaining the blessings of long life, assured of rebirth in the human realm. Before long, he'll perfect and complete the practices of universal worthy. In the past, owing to a lack of wisdom power, the 5 intermittent offenses of extreme evil I have done in one thought can all be wiped away by reciting the great kings of vows of universal worthy. Commentary, with bad advisors forever left behind. It is said, when people are close to crimson, they become red. When we are close to black ink, we become black. If we contact brown, we become brown. And if we touch yellow, we become yellow. You end up like the people with whom you associate. In China, the saying, the mother of mantras chose her neighbors, concerns the same concept. Mantra's family first lived next to a cemetery, which also had a mortuary where corpses were prepared for burial and put into caskets. At that time, Mantras was very young and like other children, he imitated his surroundings. What he saw taking place in the cemetery, he began to mimic in his play. The children made corpses and coffins out of mud and buried them in the ground and made pigs and goats and bowed to them. When his mother saw this, she said, what good is it for my child to study these kinds of things? What future is there in this? With that, She moved to another neighborhood. This time, Mansha's family found itself next to the butcher shop where pigs and sheep and so forth were killed. When Mansha began to study this kind of behavior, his mother would not stand for it, and so she again moved. This time, they moved next to a school where a scholar named Chia Chu taught students who came to study during the day, but who went home to eat and sleep. When his students entered the school, they bowed to the memorial plaque of Confucius and bowed again when they left the school, thus performing the proper etiquette for entering and leaving school. When Mansha observed the students, he began to imitate their propriety. When his mother saw this, she said, "It is right to live in a place like this. We should live here." And she enrolled Mansha in the school. As the student, Mansha would study a new subject for a few days and then lose interest. His mother would often weave at home on a loom. One day, when Mansha told her that he was not going to study anymore, his mother did not say a word but took out a knife and cut the thread of the cloth she was making. When Mansha saw that what she had done, he knew it was a mistake, and he knelt before his mother and said, "Why have you gotten angry? Did you do something wrong? Please tell me." Mansha's mother replied, "You're not studying, just like my cutting the threads of this cloth. If you don't study, you will not accomplish anything in the future." Mansha thought, "If that's the way things are, then I had better continue to study." Later, he became, after Confucius, one of China's great sages. How was he able to become a sage? He became a sage because his mother emphasized education, moving three times until she moved to a place where Mansha would have a chance to study. If his mother had not moved in the beginning when they were living next to a cemetery, then Mansha would have grown up to be a mortician and would have taken care of corpses and graves. If they had remained next to the butcher shop, Mansha would have grown up to kill sheep and pigs. As a result of their moving next to a school, however, Mansha was able to perfect his studies and become a famous scholar. The story of Mansha's education is an example of what is meant by being far away from bad advisors and drawing near to good advisors. This is the meaning of the saying, "When people are close to crimson, they become red. When we are close to black ink, we become black. If we contact brown, we become brown. And if we touch yellow, we become yellow." So, it all depends on what you are near. When you draw near good advisors, the same principle applies. You become good like them. If you meet with bad advisors, however, they will teach you wrong methods. If you stay near them, you will become like them, as they go everywhere disrupting people, being jealous and obstructing others. That is one kind of bad advisor. Do not get close to such people. Stay far away. If ever you should meet one, you should quickly get away from him. Therefore, the text reads, "With bad advisors forever left behind, why leave them behind? They do not teach you to cultivate good methods, only bad ones. From paths of evil, one departs for eternity. If you stay far away from bad advisors, you can eternally live all evil dreams. If you do not keep far away from bad advisors, however, you can easily fall into the three evil paths. The three evil paths are the hells, hungry ghosts, and animals. Asuras are also sometimes included in the evil paths, in which case they are called the four evil paths. The beings in these paths undergo the most extreme forms of suffering." Why does a person undergo extreme suffering? Suffering comes from having learned all kinds of evil knowledge from bad advisors. Studying evil knowledge, you create evil offenses, and having created evil offenses, you fall into evil paths. Therefore, when you are apart from bad advisors, you can be far away from evil paths, soon to see the first common's measureless light. When you leave all evil paths, you can go to all the good paths. That is the way things work. Extinguishing evil in itself is good. The absence of evil is good. If you do good, you will have good karma and receive a wholesome retribution. What is wholesome retribution? To quickly be able to see the Buddha. So there is a saying, quickly see the first common limitless light. You will quickly be able to draw near and see Amitabha Buddha of the land of ultimate bliss, the Buddha of limitless light, who is also known as the Buddha of limitless life, and perfect Samantabhadra's supreme vows. When you reach the land of ultimate bliss of Amitabha Buddha, you will be able to perfect the most supreme kings of vows of universal worthy Bodhisattva. Easily obtaining the blessings of a long life, a person like this will quickly obtain a superior lifespan, which means that he will have a long life. Buddhism speaks about not having the mark of a lifespan, but now the text mentions a long lifespan. Is this not the mark of a lifespan? This mark of a lifespan is not that which such a person seeks after, but comes about because he stays far away from all evil advisors, eternally leaves all evil paths, and sees Amitabha Buddha. Although one does not seek for a long life, nonetheless one obtains the reward of a long life. Not having the mark of a lifespan does not mean that if we want a long life, we cannot have a long life. Or if we want happiness, we cannot get real happiness. When you live for the land of ultimate bliss, your lifespan becomes limitless and your light becomes limitless. Amitabha Buddha has a limitless lifespan, and we can have one too. Amitabha Buddha's light is limitless, and if we are born in the land of ultimate bliss, our light will be limitless as well. Therefore, the text says such a person will easily obtain the blessings of long life. He obtains it easily because of his good karma, not because of his attachments. Assured of rebirth in the human realm, if this person wishes to teach and transform living beings, if he wants to return and be born among people, then everything he does will be perfect. This is called wishing to return. If he does not want to return, he does not need to. But if he wants to return, he comes very naturally. This is true freedom to come and go as you please. Before long, he will perfect and complete the practices of universal worthy. He will perfect the 10 great kings and vows of universal worthy Bodhisattva and all their merit and virtue. The practices he perfects are the same as those perfected by universal worthy Bodhisattva. And since the strength of universal worthy Bodhisattva's practices is the greatest, your methods of practice as well can be perfected to be identical to his. In the past, owing to a lack of wisdom power, in the past means long ago, in the distant past, earlier the text reads, for all the evil deeds I have done in the past, created by my body, mouth, and mind, from beginningless greed, anger, and delusion, I now know shame, and of them all repent. For all the evil deeds I have done in the past, created by my body, mouth, and mind, from beginningless greed, anger, and delusion. Why do we have greed, anger, and delusion? Because we do not have wisdom, and we are without the strength of prana. Why do we do evil? Because we do not have any wisdom. Therefore, we created all kinds of evil karma. One with true wisdom would not create evil karma. So the text reads, in the past, owing to a lack of wisdom power, the five unintermittent offenses of extreme evil I have done. The extreme evil I have done refers to the bad karma which people create